Okay, let's get started. We are right after lunch, so I hope you're ready for the next session here. I actually want to start by aligning expectations a little bit about this presentation. So let's say this presentation is a set of data. We talked about data quality this morning. This presentation is a set of data. So actually, Signe and I, we did our job. We put together the slides. We sent it to Hyperight. It's in the agenda. So now it's up to you guys. All right? You are the experts. you decided to come to a conference. So I can expect you to be experts in capturing knowledge, digging out all the information, take it home and make the impact. So just go ahead. That's actually how I experience how we think and how we work with data. Also this morning I saw presentations about data quality is something you handle downstream. You see the problems and then you have to go back and fix it. But we want to be more proactive and we want to take more of this upfront. So that's what we are going to talk about today. So if you're a data scientist, then your job will be a piece of cake. And what we are seeking today is actually we have developed a tool and a method for people to have a better and a constructive dialogue around data quality. We think we have done some good homework. We think we have a good tool and a good process here. But if any of you want to contribute or you want to use our tool, you are free to do that, and we would like to share and collaborate on that. So that's actually our purpose today. We already have a few people helping us here. One of them is Institute for Manufacturing at Cambridge University. We are talking to Aalborg University about collaborating about this and the Bühler Group in Germany. So just go to Vova app or LinkedIn or talk to us afterwards. That would be fine. We are from the company Grundfos. So they are, and Grundfos, that's about supporting two of UN sustainability goals, number 6 and number 13. I'll put up number 6 here on water and sanitation because there are actually some big problems out there. More than 600 million people are without clean drinking water. 2.4 billion people does not have sanitation, so children die every day because of this. That's a problem. We want to do something about it, and we come from the pump business, so we move a lot of water, both clean and dirty, so we're actually in a position where we can do something about it. Okay, enough about Grundfos. Some of the things we do, yeah, this is a kind of a how we're going to explore our strategy with the digitalization slide, something we use internally. What I want to say about this, just give a short example of what we do. When we deliver digital offerings to our customers, one example is what we start offering from this week, which is introduced, and that is for wastewater utilities. They have a problem in excess water entering the pipes, meaning that clean water actually goes to the treatment plant, and they have to pay about €7 for every cubic meter treated water. So that extra water is just extra cost. So we help them identify which pipes is the problematic one, so they can repair and replace in a good order and maintain their sewer system in an efficient way. Okay. I really want this presentation also to go a little deeper in what we have been doing and not just on the surface. So I will give the word to Signe, who will put some more substance into the presentation.
Yes. So this is a really tired data scientist, and he's tired because 80% of his time he spends on doing detective work and not interpret data and make meaning from it. First of all, he needs to get access to data. And when he gets that, he evaluates the data set, and often he finds that it does not live up to his expectations. So he needs to work around the organization and figure out who to ask and who owns the data and figure out what informations do he need to work with this data set. So how do we solve this problem? Well, good data quality is a way to solve it. So what is good data quality? Well, is good data quality a lot of data, or is it data with without holes in it, or is it data with a lot of metadata? Well, it's all these things combined, but you have to see it in relation to expectations. What does the data scientist expect from a data set? What does he need from the data set in order for him to work with it? So with this expectations in mind, in Grundfos we have developed a solution to try to avoid this, so he can look like this and only spend 20% of his time doing detective work. So we have developed a data quality assessment method, and it helps to create awareness about the data quality, and it gives the organization a common language to talk about data quality. And it also makes it easier for the data scientist to describe the data requirements. What does he need from the data in order to work with it? And of course, it will help to improve the data quality. So the method consists of three sessions. And in the first session, you will map out the data model and identify the relevant classes that need to be assessed. And in the second session, the actual assessment will take place. And in the third, there will be a dialogue about the recommendations that we analyzed through the assessment. Yes. And through the test projects that we have done so far, we have used three roles: a lead data scientist, a data scientist on the specific project where the data was assessed, and an assessor to drive the process. And we have spent 15 hours doing the assessment. So the assessment consists of three dimensions. One dimension is data definition. And the purpose of this dimension is to assess the quality of the metadata. Each of the dimensions are divided into factors, and we'll come back to that later. And then there's data quality. And this revolves around this assessment is done in a more quantitative manner. Then you look at your data set and see how much of the data set lives up to the requirements that you have written down. And then there's data availability. Here you assess the fairness of data. And fair data has to be findable. So it's not good if the data set is only available on your individual laptops, because then it's only you who can get access to it. And accessibility means that as a new employee or one who has not created the data set, it's easy to find out how to get access, where to get access, and who to go to. And data also has to be interoperable. This means that data can be used across the organization. And last, it has to be reusable, which means it's kept up to date at all times.
Yeah, so one more word on this. Do you remember this morning the talk about the butterfly effect, about using your data across the company? That's really what we want to achieve here. So we empower the different part of our organization to be able to create good data themselves, so we can use it across, so we don't rely on a central organization then fixing the data.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we don't focus so much on the exact system or how to structure the data, and more to empower the organization that sits on the data and understand the data to create good data themselves that is really easy to interpret and easy to read, because it has these.
So to assess your data set, you need some anchoring statements, and as you see here. These are the factors for each dimension, and I've chosen the data definition dimension. And for each factor, there are 5 anchoring statements, and they are ranged in a score from 0 to 12 points. So what you do with your data set is that you have to find the worst and the best case. And for example, you look at datetime fields. If your datetime is user-entered and there's no backup battery, then you score 0 points. But if the datetime is set by a server, then you score 12 points. And you will go through the relevant factors, because there might be some factors that are not relevant for your data set, and then you score for each dimension, sorry, factor. And 6 points indicate an OK score. So if your data set scores 6 points or above, it's actually quite good to work with as a data scientist. And during the assessment, you have to score the assessment, and you use this tool to do it. And it gives you an overview of how your data set scores. So the color you want to see here is green. If you see a lot of red, as we do here, it's an indicator that the data quality is quite poor. So you want to do something especially to the zeros and the threes, because that's the places where the data scientists have real problems working with the data. So it gives an overview, and it also documents the possible improvements. So during the assessment and the interview session, we figure out, okay, this scores 0 points, what do we need to do in order to make it better? And then in the last session, it all comes together to a possible improvement guideline. So we have tested this in 3 projects so far, and what we have found out is that when we work with the data set and these recommendations, we have tried to make an interactive documentation using Power BI. We found that, well, we have described the metadata, it improves the data quality. But using an interactive documentation, we found that, well, we figured out that there were findings we would not have seen without the assessment. For example, we work with pumps, and we found out that a software version was attached to old pumps, where the software version was not even developed. So it helps you to understand your data set, where are the challenges, and what do you need to do in order to improve it and make the job easier for the data scientist. Yeah,
and the whole idea here is, because we also learned this morning that then you can put you can have some tools, and you can then improve your data if the quality is poor. But the idea is here to facilitate a dialogue between the data scientist and the subject matter experts about what is good data quality, because often this dialogue has been, okay, the data quality is poor, or the data quality is good. Oh, we have access to data, yes, we don't have access to data, so it's very black and white. So we want really to open up that space in between, so it's not like a winner and a loser, but it's more like, okay, we need to help each other, and as a data scientist, we will benefit from better data, and as a subject matter expert, this is a way for you to explain in a data language what it actually means, what we are doing. So some of the learnings, we put them up here. One of the learnings were that in one of the projects, we had we were focusing a lot of the problems in the data, but during the assessment, the data scientist came back and said, okay, I can actually see most of the data I'm using is actually quite good quality. I'm just focusing on the problems. So that's what I have in my mind. So now I'm much more confident about the project I'm doing, because I can see I have a lot of good data compared to my peers in other projects. Another example is a development project we are doing where we even just start using this assessment, and then we realized that the unique identifier of a data set that coupled the data set with the equipment, that's creating that identifier in the software that did the data was deprioritized because it was not in the original scope of the project, which is a major fault if you want to use a data set on equipment afterwards, right? So we figured out this, you need to have this in place, and we could have a good dialogue about it instead of just pointing fingers and said, you need to do this because we say so. So they could understand what was behind.
Yeah, and then we tested on a project, and this data scientist had a new project, and he actually wanted to use it before even getting access to data, because he saw the point in analyzing what kind of data requirements he has. So it can be used at many different stages in a project, and it can also be used again and again to see where data, because it evolves through time.
Okay, you will, yeah.
Yeah, so it's a method for creating awareness about data capability, quality. It should really help to start the dialogue about data quality. What is it and what do we expect it to be in our organization? How do we see it? And as I said before, it helps to describe the data requirements and also discover new things. And most importantly, it helps you to improve the data quality and make the job easier for the data scientist and more efficient.
Yeah, yeah. So it's not like we only do a data quality in Grundfos, of course. We do the full data value chain, but today we wanted to focus on this subject and go a little bit deeper. And we're willing to share this tool if any of you think that it could be useful. But what we would like in return is some collaboration, and if you try it out or you improve it, then we would like to benefit from that as well, because we actually think this is not only something we need to overcome in Grundfos in order to be able to make more analytics, more fault detection, more prediction. We think it's actually a general problem in the industry that we need to empower. We need to empower the subject matter experts. We need to empower the people that create the data to make good data. And we need to empower. We need them to be able to understand what is actually good quality that comes out of what I'm doing. Okay?
Yeah.
So we have plenty of time for questions, so please shoot.
Yeah. Yeah. One problem or difficulty that I ever see with a lot of data is when you get data from different places or different divisions, the metadata can be really different, which is like, you know, difficult to combine the data of the same kind. And also, maybe it's very beneficial if data scientists can communicate. I mean, the communication can be both ways, so that he or she can define what kind of metadata one wants to work with or wants the data attached with.
Yeah, so I can I fully follow. I think I follow what you are saying about this.
My problem with is like the difficulties with getting metadata from different sources to align with each other. Same data type can have different kinds of metadata attached to it, and that can be really problematic for a data scientist to work with.
And yeah, so if it's exactly the same data type, then of course you can align the metadata. But what we also want to achieve here is to be able to combine data from very different sources, like from customer insights and from operational data and from HR and from the supply chain, and then these functions they work with very different tools and different types of databases. So we want them to be able to work in their environment with their databases, but they need to really describe. So what does the data contain? So they need to do good metadata, not just a word. In the worlds of pumps, flow is really important, and often we see a column called flow, but we don't know if it's a measured flow, estimated flow, a calculated flow, or we don't know what it is. So of course there needs to be a description. But if the description is not there, you will not score that high on your data set. So you need to describe what is actually in your data set. Then you will score high, and that's a way to have this dialogue. Did that answer your question?
Yeah. Did you start by mentioning anything about data governance in the beginning?
Sorry, did you mention anything about data governance?
No, we didn't mention about that, but I can talk a little bit about the data governance. The way I see it is that for us, we have a lot of good data on our products that describe our products. And we have a really strong governance on that in our company. So we are quite confident that we can build governance around data. Where we see the big problems is more data that comes from our products and from our customers. So the governance there is lagging behind. And the way we chose to go with this was actually not to put much governance in place in the first place, but actually work with methods about how to do this dialogue and learn about how to do that and be good at that before we put the governance in place. Now this is a closed room, so I can say this, there's only video on, but I want the people that works with the data to set the standards. I don't want people in steering committee and doing governance to set the standard about the quality of the data. So.
Good move.
Okay. Somebody more? Yeah, good.
You have 10 minutes.
Yeah. That's, yeah.
Yes. So this is Bjarke van Danfoss. I think it's a quite interesting idea to have this kind of framework for data quality. Do you think the model is well suited for all types of data sets, or does it have limitations? Let's start there.
The ambition is that it's suited for all types of data sets. What we've seen so far, we tested it on three projects, and we made three iterations on one type of data to improve it, and then we actually did not have to improve much over time. But that's an ambition to have it work across a lot of data sets. And that's also why we asked for collaboration here, because if you would try the model on a different data set, then we could improve it even more, and then it's more generic. Because the idea is to get this butterfly effect, so we can really work with data across not only functions, but also between companies.
Yeah, and so far we have tested on static data and also time series data, and it got through with that, so that's quite nice. But of course, maybe need some tweaks on other data sets, but yeah.
The method is, the origin of the method we're using here is a way to build scoring tools. I'm not a big fan of a fixed scoring tool you use on everything, but I'm a big fan of adjusting and creating a scoring tool for the purpose. And that's what we're doing here. And what you also show, Signe, in the process, there is a step of adjusting the process or the tool. So that kind of adapts a lot of differences in data sets.
Yeah, exactly. Because I think there needs to be a certain flexibility in the method in order to not kill the purpose.
Definitely.
Yeah, exactly.
So for giving recommendations of improving data sets, are you always involved in that process or how does that work?
Yeah, so far. So right now we are a little team doing these assessments, so I actually combine all the possible improvement statements and then I deliver a feedback. So, and then we have a dialogue about which of the possible improvements are relevant and the trade-off between how much time do you need to do this improvement and what will you gain from it. So it's also identifying which is most important and set it up against how much time do you need to spend on it. Yeah.
There's a question in... we are not there. I would say we are not there yet, where we are able to set standards. But it's something that we want to come after this. We want to understand so how are we actually doing before we start setting standards.
But I mean, using ISO standards and
something. Well, yeah. In general, in Grundfos, yes. But on this, when in the software that sits in our products that create the data, it's not the ISO standards now. Do you know if there is an ISO standard? I'm actually not aware of that.
No.
So the answer must be no. So, yeah.
Have you considered any workflow for how to correct data quality when you found deviations and how to make sure that data quality also stays good in the future? For example, working with processes to ensure that the data quality is good in future?
Uh, Yeah, so we don't have a described process at the moment, no. But we have considered to do this. The thinking is that the data governance and the processes we are using on our product data, that we will take those processes and adapt for more data sets.
Okay, more questions? We have 5 minutes more. My interest in this was so we are doing a lot of these data governance conferences around, and it seems to be a very frightening subject. It never matures. I think in entire Nordics there is around 90 data governance people in general with a title, and in Sweden there is 9 CDOs only, right? Which is super scary. But what I like about this is that you are trying to win a proof of concept before you go to enterprise data quality. This is your end goal, right?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay, cool. Any questions?
Okay, but you can also come and talk to us afterwards, and especially if you're interested in working a little bit together. So, yeah.
Yeah. Good. So, a big applause. Yep.